Welcome to Lifestyle Solopreneur, the community for entrepreneurs who put lifestyle first. Join your host, Flavia Barris, as she interviews successful lifestyle solopreneurs and shares ideas to help you find the perfect balance between lifestyle, business, and self. Flavia is an attorney, marketing expert, and founder of several online academies. She's been featured in major media, including BBC World News, The Wall Street Journal, The New York Post, ESPN Television, and more. Join us for this episode of Lifestyle Solopreneur.
Hey, Lifestyle Solopreneurs. Today we are so excited we get to chat with Mark Willis. He is a certified financial planner, a number one best-selling author, and the owner of Lake Growth Financial Services, a financial firm in Chicago, Illinois. Over the years, he has helped hundreds of his clients take back control of their financial future and build their businesses with sophisticated, tax-efficient financial solutions. He specializes in building custom-tailored financial strategies that are unknown to typical stock jockeys, attorneys, or other financial gurus. As co-host of the Not Your Average Financial Podcast, he shares some of his strategies for investing in real estate, saving and paying for college without going broke, and creating an income in retirement that you can't outlive. Mark works with people who want to grow their wealth in ways that are safe and predictable, become their own source of financing, can't wait to hear more about that, and create tax-free income in retirement. Mark, welcome to the show.
Well, thank you very much, Flavia. It's a pleasure to be here.
Yeah, so excited to have you. And as I mentioned to you a little earlier, I am so excited that there is someone on the podcast who's going to take an otherwise maybe boring topic that people like to avoid and not really think about, like retirement planning and, you know, taxes and all these topics that people shy away from, and make it accessible and fun and interesting. And it's really something we all need to think about, at least, you know, hopefully monthly or weekly, but at least quarterly. And for those of you who don't want to think about it at all, at least take once a year a little, you know, sabbatical for a day and really think about your finances, your future, and do some planning. It's so important. So, Mark, how did you get started in financial planning?
Well, I don't know about boring. I think it's so cool. I think it's the coolest thing you could think about and talk about and work on and plan for. I'm just kidding, of course. I know that numbers are not exactly what everyone just bounds out of bed to think about and work on, which is, I guess, why they keep me around. But I literally stumbled into becoming a financial planner. I was working alongside a CPA, helping her with some tax preparations. And I started that job only because I really became personally very interested in my own personal financial situation. When my wife and I left college, we had three private school degrees between us and over six figures of student loan debt and no plan to pay it off. It was almost like a mortgage had been handed to us, but no house.
And that's not unusual these days.
Yeah. It was. Yeah. I mean, that's more and more common. And we graduated in the summer of 2008. So I don't know if you can think of what else is going on in the world economy that year, Flavia, but, you know, it wasn't exactly a great time to be looking for a job.
Right. Everyone just picture a soap bubble popping. Yeah, was that year.
So we stumbled into personal finance, got our own stuff together, started doing kind of your typical financial mainstream financial wisdom, investing in the stock market as best we could, paying down our debt like nobody's business, until we stumbled across some strategies that kind of woke us up to, you know, maybe there's even a better way than what we were being taught. And to be honest, when I was working with the CPA, I was troubled because I was hearing her, nationally recognized CPA, but I was hearing her make calls to some clients, some of whom were in their early 60s, 62, 63 years old. And Flavia, they were about to retire, and she was making calls saying things like, "I'm sorry, Mr. Client, but we just lost half your life savings. Ouch. You can't retire yet."
Ouch, ouch, ouch.
Yeah. And for a young financial planner looking at making that my career, I didn't want to build another house of cards, only to see them all tumble down when the next recession came. So it kind of started me on a journey of looking for what else is out there. If Wall Street doesn't have every answer, how can we possibly meet our goals? without taking a bunch of unnecessary risks.
Well, clearly you've done it well because, you know, you're the typical like garage entrepreneur story where I think you were working maybe out of a bedroom, right, at the beginning.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then you've grown now to where you have a staff and you're, you know, in downtown in an office. So what was that like to go from just leaving her? I suppose from her, you went just out on your own. Was that that next step for you?
Correct. Yeah. Started, hung my own shingle, got my own licenses and everything. Ended up getting my certified financial planner professional designation, among other steps that I had to hoops that I had to jump through. It's not easy to start a business in the state of Illinois. So we started in my front bedroom and graduated to a co-office space back before those were even cool. But I still love those days. I really cherish those moments. It was a timber loft in downtown Chicago. So high heels were my arch nemesis because, you know, if you've never been inside a timber loft building, anyone walking above you with high heels is sort of like gunshots going off above your head.
Keeps you awake though. You don't need coffee.
Yeah, it's like, oh, exactly. Yeah. So I had a ton of fun. We brought on staff, hired on some additional financial associates, financial planners that work with us now. And the rest is history. We've had a lot of fun growing and, we've opened up some office space and, built out some office space here in downtown Chicago, and I've had a tremendous amount of fun doing it.
Now, we have a lot of solopreneurs who are taking those first baby steps in business, and it's scary, and they might be sitting in their bedroom in their pajamas, and that's their business. They're starting out, and they're wondering if they'll ever get there. What was really instrumental for you in getting those first few clients to trust you, you know, a guy working out of his bedroom with their financial information, their financial future, and how did you make that leap to get people to pay you for your expertise?
Yeah. Well, you know, invest in yourself is the first thing I can say. And I don't just mean with money, but I mean with your education. Learn, you know, as much as you can. And you know, when you're speaking over the phone, you can be anywhere and anyone. And that can be a good thing or a bad thing. So first of all, earn their trust and grow and invest in yourself. Put the time and money even into weekend classes or credentials or whatnot. Whatever you can do to sort of flatten that trust curve where you can help them see that you're someone worth doing business with. And then help them, whoever your market is, help them learn something new from you. I've learned that, to be very honest, when you are a coach or a teacher rather than, you know, some kind of sleazy salesman, you can usually give them a brand new way of thinking about something. And that can be like $1 million in the way of just trust building. Because when you help folks see something new, everything else is, you sort of become their teacher and their coach and their guide. And that's truly what we try to strive for here, to always have the heart of a teacher with everyone we work with. And you don't need to have, you know, a big fancy building to do that. You just need to have a new way of thinking about whatever it is that your business is focused on. If you're going to be in health and fitness and diet or whatnot, make that your baby. Make that your passion. Help folks see their wellness and fitness in a brand new way. If you're going to be in finance, help, you know, find new ways to think about money, challenge conventional wisdom, and of course, give folks the opportunity to learn something new or think a new way about money.
And I just heard you say the word help and, you know, teaching so many times in what you were just saying. So I think in some ways, if we distill it down, if you're really serving people, like really helping them, really teaching them and making that your huge focus, it really doesn't matter if you're in flip-flops and PJs, you know, working out of a corner of your dining room, right? I mean, that's what it's all mm-hmm. about. And that's where the value is. And people will respond and you will get clients because they will respond to your passion. I mean, that's what I have found and seen. And I've spoken to a lot of solopreneurs at this point, and that seems to be the common theme. So if you feel you're not getting enough clientele, think really carefully about what you're giving versus just what you're receiving, which is the payment and the fees.
Oh yeah. I just fell in love with my clients. I remember that when we first were getting started, it was almost bordering on a obsession. I loved seeing them reach their financial goals. I loved giving them a pathway to get there. I mean, we'd sit down one-on-one, and we still do every single day, you know, building out blueprints, listening to their real heart. I truly believe, Flavia, that a financial conversation about someone's long-term goals should be like those deep conversations of the heart. You know, the kind of conversations you remember for a lifetime. And if it's if you're meeting with a financial advisor and all they're doing is punching numbers into a spreadsheet and it feels like they're extracting data out of you, run for the hills. I feel like you know, if you're going to be making this a lifelong relationship with someone, almost like a counselor or a a best friend that's going to help you get to where you want to go, a mentor or a guide. Those conversations should be something that draws out of the deepest parts of you to help you get to where you want to go.
That's amazing. And that's the way it should be. And so let's give listeners a little bit about those kinds of conversations that they can use in their own life. Because I know you're an expert in financial tools for small business owners, whether it's a solopreneur or someone that's got maybe just a few employees. And a lot of folks go into business, and I love them for this. I love us for this, right? Entrepreneurs, we leap and then aim, right? We leap and then check like, oh, is there a trampoline down there? And that's okay. And that's, you know, and you need courage to be an entrepreneur. And so sometimes courage goes hand in hand with lack of planning. Because if you start planning and you plan too long, sometimes your courage just dies and then you never launch. So there's a balance somewhere in there. But I would say a lot of solopreneurs launch before they have all their ducks in a row, and that's fine. So there may be a lot of listeners in that situation where they're even already making money, but they never set up some of the financial tools they probably should think about. So what are the most common financial tools that solopreneurs neglect to take care of that you want to remind folks about?
Wow. Well, we'll start simple and we'll go complex. I always like to take a long-term view approach. You know, because if you think about it, when are we ever not going to need money in our lifetime? So taking a long view, I mean, it'd be great to look 4 or 5 generations into the future. I think that's probably the best way to go. But start at least, you know, there's an old quote that says, rich people plan for 4 generations, but poor people plan for Saturday night. And right. I feel like a lot of business owners, maybe it's not Saturday night, but maybe it's every payroll or every time the bill is due or whatever. And most of us are just running from bill to bill to operating expense to operating expense, and we forget to pay ourselves first. So, you know, there's a lot of tips and tools out there on just running your business well. So I'll start with that. One, there are ways you can set aside funds before you spend them on your bills and operating expenses to set it aside into a totally separate account where you don't even see it anymore until it's time to give yourself that nice fat profit check every quarter. You know, you are the operator of a corporation now if you run a small business, even if that corporation is one person sitting in their pajamas. So set aside a little bit. You can do this automatically where, you know, 30% of every deposit that comes into your business bank account goes right into a profit account for you. And your bank can help you set that up. Budgeting software can help you set that up. So I guess I'm saying something there, but I'm almost forgetting to mention that it's important to have different accounts to separate your personal money from your business money. So depending on how far into your business you are, you'll realize that it's super easy to commingle those funds. You know, oh yeah, I'm out for pizza with my friends, but I've got more money in my business account, or I don't have a business account, so I'm just going to swipe that credit card or that debit card. So it's really important. Step one is to separate those finances so you're not mixing your personal stuff with your business stuff. Does that make sense so far, Flavia?
Perfect sense. And, you know, the lawyer in me's got to pipe up and say, yes, yes, commingling is bad. It can also cause you, it could in some ways cause a creditor to disregard or be able to prove that your corporation should be disregarded because you weren't treating it like a corporation. You were treating it like just yourself.
Well said.
So, you know, that's That is such fundamental key advice. And I'd love to say, well, that, you know, no one needs that. That's obvious, but it's not. People need to know this. Mm-hmm. It is not obvious. People make this mistake all the time. So I think that's great advice. And then as far as sort of bookkeeping early on, what do you recommend that solopreneurs do for their sort of early day bookkeeping when they're not quite at the point where they feel like shelling out a few bucks? And it's less money than you think, folks, to hire a bookkeeper. But at the beginning, a lot of solopreneurs are like, I'm just going to do it myself. Number one, I don't want to tell anyone how little I'm making yet. So I don't want to share it with anyone. And two, I don't want to have to pay someone, you know, to input my 10 receipts for the month. So what do you think would be that first, you know, when should you take that first bookkeeping step? Should you hire a bookkeeper? Should you just invest in a, you know, software like QuickBooks and self-teach yourself? What would you recommend?
Yeah, well, so very quickly, because, you know, we're looking at today's dollars now, and I'd love to talk also about future dollars like retirement plans and so forth. But, you know, on the current, what do we need to do with the money we have until we get paid again kind of a question. I like to think about, one, you can use apps for documenting all your receipts. When you get that receipt, you don't have to keep it in a shoebox somewhere. There's actually an app called Shoeboxed. And there's probably three dozen other competitors out there. But for free, you can take a picture of that receipt, and then it gets automatically categorized. I do recommend that you find somebody on Odesk or something similar to Odesk, where you get a virtual bookkeeper for 5 to 10 hours a month. I mean, almost everyone can afford that to cover the cost for a bookkeeper for $5 to $10 a month. Once again, creditor protection when you get possibly sued, for example, God forbid, you've got another person who's been helping audit and manage your in and outs, your reconciling. And then as far as that's the past, what about the present and the future? So QuickBooks and reconciling your receipts, that's fine for what happened yesterday. But what about revenue forecasts? How are you going to get from where you are now to where you want to go with your business? Because what you're doing, if you're starting a business, is you're building an asset. Almost treat it like a stock in your portfolio. And if you can imagine your business like a stock in your financial portfolio, you want it to become profitable so it grows in value. You know what? Who has stock that doesn't want it to grow in value? So one of the things you can do there is create a cash flow forecast. And you can do that on Excel or on a legal pad. But there's another thing, you can use certain budgeting softwares that help you do this. But if you can look forward and say, all right, here's what I can expect, almost like a weather forecast. Here's the revenue and revenue I can expect and the expenses I can expect until I get paid again. It's almost like giving every dollar a job. So you can confidently spend the money you have in your account without running out before you get the next deposit from, you know, your vendors or from your clients or customers. So you're building in that sort of system where you're looking forward. I mean, as the visionary and as the business owner, it's your job to look into the future. Let your bookkeeper look into the past for you. Does that make sense?
It makes perfect sense. And I think a lot of folks who are more of the holistic or spiritual tendency, who also, you know, tend to dislike these numbers and being boxed in with spreadsheets and all of this, think about it this way. You know, if you believe in manifestation and you believe in visualization, and I was to ask you, how much revenue will you likely make in the next year? And you truly just have this question mark in your head, like, I don't know. I have no idea. I just hope some, maybe a lot. I don't know. That's not good. And so the advice you're giving about projecting your cash flows and planning for the future and what your business is going to do 12 months from now, 3 years from now, it is really important because it does give you a goal. And it does give you also a way to prove to, let's say you're applying for loans or you're trying to get investors into your business, they're going to need to see all of this. And investors aren't going to love it if you tell them, well, I've never actually had those productions, so I put some together last night for this meeting for the first time ever. I mean, that's not going to look good. So it's definitely something you want to do at the very beginning and make it a habit, and don't wait until you need to show these documents to someone. You should have this even when it's just you looking at them, right?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely, yes. I mean, hope is, as they say, is not a strategy. So if you want to be successful, if you want to grow that wonderful thing called your business, if you love the idea of being an entrepreneur, I want you to stay in that spot. You know, the worst thing that could happen is that you become unfortunately a statistic where, you know, what is the statistic? Everyone misquotes it, where the vast majority of businesses don't make it past their fifth year. And the primary reason is because they had financial problems. They had cash flow problems. I recently read a book that said that that businesses start by creating essentially a Frankenstein. This business is sort of a Frankenstein, and we have to keep feeding the beast, and it keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And unless we take control of those expenses and look forward on in terms of our revenue, we'll end up being consumed by it, and we will never, you know, take a salary, and we'll eventually become part of that statistic. So, similar to that is this idea of, you know, still setting aside for your future, like your far away future. Flavia, I heard the other day, a recent study was done that when people think about their future selves, as in retirement, that the same part of the brain is activated as when they're thinking about a stranger.
Interesting. Wow.
Think about that. Think about what that does to like our desire to save or set aside for the future or you know, think about what our tax rate might be when we get older. If we're thinking of ourselves as strangers, future selves as strangers, we're probably not going to treat them very nicely.
Right.
So how do we get close? And actually there's an app that you can take a picture of yourself and see what you'd look like 30 years from now. It's kind of weird. /cool. But I love to think in the long range because I think it helps us ask more fundamental sets of questions. Like, what do I truly want out of life? What do I think I am going to be doing someday? What's my exit plan for my business? And when you're just starting your business, it's hard to think about what I'll do to get out of it. But the truth is, all of us will leave our businesses someday, whether we are doing it intentionally or we're forced out because of death or disability. So what's your exit strategy? And will you be able to sell this business to somebody for $10 million, $100 million? Is that going to be 2 years from now or 30 years from now? And if you aren't thinking about that now, it'll be forced upon you, and it won't be as favorable an outcome. Would you agree on that, Flavia?
Oh, I agree completely. I mean, I think there is a fear of aging, and nobody's in a hurry to get to 80, right? I mean, that's
right.
Very few people, because you want to enjoy your time now. You're living in the moment. Most people live in the moment. And I think that's probably a survival. I'm not a psychologist, but I would guess that if we're not living in the moment and we're just always dwelling at the end of our life and thinking about it, well, that's not really a way to live. And you're not going to play life real well if you're always just focused on where you'll be when you're 90. But because we sort of avoid... You're right. I mean, how can we plan if we're not relating to that person, that 90-year-old version of ourselves, and taking care of that person and providing for them by making moves today to make sure that the 90-year-old you isn't lacking food and medical care and everything that,
sure,
that
yeah.
I would hate to say doesn't happen, but it does. It happens quite often. There's a lot of folks out there today who did not plan for retirement. They're not doing so well. You know, hopefully they had a lot of kids and all the kids are stepping up and taking care of grandpa and grandma to fill in that gap. But there's a lot of elder folks right now who are not self-sufficient.
Absolutely. Yeah. And that's partly what gets me up out of bed in the morning is to help, you know, stem that tide, not just with those that are approaching retirement now, but also those that are just starting out. So I love to get folks to think about those more fundamental sets of questions. Again, you know, what do I want to be when I grow up? Even if that growing up is at retirement, what kind of lifestyle do we want to live? What does the word retirement even mean to us? You know, it's changing. The definition for many of the, I ask every client this question, and it's been evolving over the years as we've been doing this. What does it mean? Most of us now, my anecdotal experience is that most of us see retirement as just another chapter in our lives where we pick up a new business or a part-time business or you know, some sort of ongoing income streams of some kind. So, you know, learning to ask yourself a couple of fundamental questions, you know, really helps here. And one thing in particular has been a realization for me is that where your money lives will make it do different things. And again, that's one of those, I call them BFOs, you know, brilliant flashes of the obvious. But where our money lives has a big part to play in the usage of that money. You know, a hedge fund is going to be different than a savings account, right?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, just so risk levels, and you're right. There's certain money needs to live in certain places.
So helpful sometimes to just have a set of questions. And this is where a coach or a financial planner really comes into play. Asking yourself these questions, you know, who else besides you will profit on your money if it's in a 401k, for example, or an IRA? What risks are you taking with your money, and are you willing to accept those risks? You know, one thing that I've noticed is that a lot of entrepreneurs are taking speculative risk with their business, and that's a good thing. I love good risk, especially if it's money I can afford to lose. If it's money I can't afford to lose, I'm not willing to risk it myself, of course. So I like to think of most entrepreneurs as having this strategy called the barbell strategy. And that's where you've got 10% of your money in super speculative instruments like your business. You know, and if we look at the statistics of failure for businesses, we have to put the business owner and his or her business in what I call the speculative bucket. You know, so your money in your business, the business account that you have, the inventory you've purchased, you know, the investment you've made into this small business of yours, whether it's 2 weeks old or 10 years old, is in the speculative part of your portfolio. So almost think of it sort of like one end of a barbell.
Mm-hmm.
Now, way over on the other side of the barbell is, and I think should be, balanced appropriately with super conservative places to pack away cash. And I'm not talking about a shoebox or a checking account that won't earn any interest, but I'm thinking about big buckets that you can pour money into when you do get profit, because your money has to live somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
So you can either put it in an IRA or a SEP, you know, simplified employee pension, or any of these other small business accounts, and then it's unavailable for you to use for your business or your family until you're 59 and a half years old. So that's one option. Or, and per most of our small business owners, putting it into big buckets of cash that, you know, still give them a rate of return that beats inflation, but is liquid and available for them, is usually a good winning strategy. I mean, if you had $100,000 in a cash equivalent, like a money market account or high early cash value life insurance policies, for example, you could use that money for your business, and there's no market risk on that money. So you've created for yourself this nice barbell where 90% of your wealth is over in these conservative instruments like cash and cash equivalents over here. And way over on the other side of the barbell is your business. And so when your business needs money, you just take from the conservative cash and throw it at your business. When banks stop lending, you just take it from your cash, and, you know, you take advantage of the down market when the banks aren't lending and the markets are crashing and all your competitors can't use their credit cards because their lines of credit have been slashed. You got to believe that'll make you more competitive.
Right.
If you are the one with the liquid money.
And you're big on that, on financing your own loans, you know, so speak to that a little bit. What is that model? Because for a lot of folks, you're like, what is be your own banker? What, how, what? So
yeah.
What do you mean by that when you teach on that?
It's one of my favorite strategies. I mean, if you think about it, banks have been around. I just finished, Flavia, I just finished the book, Debt, the First 5,000 Years. That was the title of the book.
So, oh, wow. You know, how many
banks
pages?
Have been around.
It sounds pretty thick.
it was a thick one for sure. Yeah, it was on Audible, so it took me a couple of weeks to read it. But,
oh, that's good, because you don't want to hold that on your chest, you know.
Oh, as man, yeah.
That
yeah.
thing was probably talk big about, enough to be a home security device.
Oh, sure, you bet. You talk about your debt weighing you down. That's literally what's going on with that physical hardback, I'm sure. But yeah, so the concept of banks being in our lives is not going away. I mean, they're literally the most profitable business model in the world. They've been around for thousands of years, and I don't think they're going anywhere. So either we can be, you know, used for their convenience, or we can find ways to become the bank for our convenience. So I like to tell my clients that you're already in the banking business. If you think about it, we have two jobs. You know, we have two jobs already. We're in the business that has our business card, you know, that we've written on our business card, and we're in the banking business already. We're just sitting on the wrong side of the banker's desk. What if you could become your own source of financing? What if you could actually literally cut out banks, credit cards, finance companies, mortgages, and become your own source of financing, recapturing the interest that you currently pay them and pay it to yourself instead? And we have a whole system of lessons we teach on this, and particular financial strategies and financial products that help clients do that. But it has revolutionized countless of our clients' businesses and personal lives.
So do you mean like borrowing against your own 401k or borrowing against a whole life insurance policy, or, you know, what are some of the categories? And it's going to be, folks, it's not one size fits all. There's going to be strategies that would work for one person in their situation, not for somebody else. So if we give examples, it's definitely not to tell you this is how you should be your own bank, but there Correct. Are lots of models out there. I've, you know, heard of many, I'm familiar with some, but then there's always kind of new innovative ways to look at it as well.
Absolutely. Yeah, definitely. We'll put the CFP disclaimer. This is not investment advice, and, you know, talk to your advisor and so forth for sure. We found that, you know, there are two kinds of loans. There's recourse loans and non-recourse loans. So what are recourse loans? Those are ones that you have to pay back. So your auto loan, your credit cards, your 401k loan, all of those will demand a repayment schedule from you. Your house mortgage, all those things require a repayment plan. One of the only places I can find a non-recourse loan where you don't have to pay it back is a life insurance policy. So like you said, a whole life insurance policy, Flavia, you can use a whole life policy's cash value for your business. We used our policy that I have personally to help build the office space that I'm currently housing my business in. We borrowed from the policy. There's no repayment plan. If I never repay the loan, the insurance company won't mind. When I pass away, they'll simply deduct that from my death benefit. My family will get $2 million minus 10 grand or whatever it costs to build the office. So it's a non-recourse loan, totally tax-free to access the loan, and it's a guaranteed pool of money. So when the banks stop lending again in the next recession, man, what a great place to tap money to grow and expand my business. I'm actually, hate to sound sort of foreboding here, but if there is another market correction or recession, I don't wish any pain on anyone, but it'll be a great opportunity for those who position themselves to take advantage of opportunities. I'm sure you know this with real estate, Flavia, and it works the same in business. You know, it's those that had the cash that made the most in the last recession, and of course, even the Great Depression of the 1920s and 30s.
Right. And it is so amazing. And that's why what you do is so helpful for folks, because you are that, you know, coach and counselor and advisor that helps people plan for recessions. And I know that sounds so pessimistic, and I would love, love, love to be able to say, actually, we'll probably never have a recession again. It's all going to go up from here forever and ever and ever. The chart is just going to head upwards. I can't say that. I don't think anyone can say that. I don't think, you know, the realistic way to look at life is everything has cycles. We all have cycles. Our health has cycles, our everything. And
sure.
Life is a cycle, and the economy has cycles. It's just, you look at history and that's the way it's always been. That's probably the way it'll always be. And you need to plan for all aspects of that cycle. And some people plan better than others. And definitely folks that have help usually come out ahead, even during and after a recession, than those who got blindsided and did no planning, right?
Absolutely. Yeah, it's those that two things. One, those that had help, as you mentioned, those that had a true guide and a coach to guide them through that storm, and also that set up and prepared for it, you know, and even looked forward to it in some ways, looked forward to it. Because I agree, I think your audience certainly knows that there's going to be another day when we're going to get bad news on our evening TV shows and on the radio and so forth. It'll cycle through once again, and economic winters come in a regular way. In fact, I was just reading, on average, over the last century, the stock market has at least temporarily throughout the year lost an average of 14% every single year. And every 3 to 5 years, it loses on average 34%.
Wow. So interesting.
Yeah. So wouldn't you want to take advantage when everything goes on sale at 30% off every 3 years to buy that up or to move on that opportunity when those times come? It's those that have prepared for it in advance that'll be the most ready for it when those days come.
Yeah. And these are the strategies of the very successful and the strategies of the wealthy. And the way to become wealthy and successful is to utilize the same strategies. So it's really good for everyone to just realize we can all learn more and do more in these areas. Now, you probably have a lot of drain on your time, and people are very demanding, and you have a lot of clients that need help, and there's a pull on you, I'm sure, to work 24 hours a day. So we're big on balance here at Lifestyle Solopreneur. What do you do to keep yourself sane and to keep yourself from becoming a workaholic and from slipping over into, you know, the dark side of not coming out of your office for 7 days in a row?
Yeah, great question. Well, my wonderful wife has really helped me here. We at our offices have set up 8 core values that guide us to doing what we should do and shouldn't do in our business. One of those core values is finding balance in all areas of life, you know, our work, our social life, spiritual life, and so forth. And I really believe that that makes a lot of difference. We talk about those values with our team and our advisors. And, you know, it's important to build. I mean, there's this idea that you reach balance, and I don't think you ever do. You know, when I'm balancing on a high wire or something, or on a high point, I'm never truly settled. My balance is always correcting from the last mistake, if that makes sense. So I feel like balance is sort of a misnomer, or a myth. But I think it's something we're always striving toward, if that makes any sense.
Oh, I've even used that analogy before in bicycles too, because it's all about constant course correction and being actually aware of where you are so that you know your tipping point. And so as soon as you are tipping over into workaholism, that's a tough word, right? As soon as you feel yourself tipping into that, you need to actually correct and you know, nudge yourself the other way.
So we've decided as a family that I'm in at the office no earlier than 8:30, and I'm out the door here no later than 3:30 every day. And that's Monday through Thursday. And then Fridays I usually take off to be with family. And then Saturday I do take Saturday appointments. That's worked out well for me. So I split my weekends, Fridays and Sundays. But I try to keep I have absolutely no wiggle room on evening appointments anymore. I used to do that. I used to work all day meeting with clients 6-7 days a week. Don't do that anymore. I used to go into the office on Sundays sometimes. Don't do that anymore. I just didn't find the kind of life I wanted to live. We get into this business to control our schedules, not let our business control us. And time is the most valuable asset any of us have.
So when you took out that loan from one of your investments in order to do some improvements in your office, did you install a trap door that goes off at 3:30 that dumps you right into your car, right under your chair? Just boom.
Hey, that's a great idea.
You're still sitting here. Yeah. Boom. Right there, right in your car.
Don't tell my wife that. She might actually help get that installed, a little eject button from my office chair here. Yeah.
Well, I mean, you would need a convertible car. So maybe, you know, that's a nice excuse to buy a new car and have a, you know. Although in Chicago, I don't really know if convertibles are the thing, really.
Yeah, no. If we're going to have a convertible, we need like a windshield for the ice and all that stuff. So, yeah, totally.
I mean, just convertibles with their little cloth tops. They just don't keep in the heat. I don't know how you'd make it. But I love Chicago. I kid you. I actually love Chicago. Even when it's cold, there's something refreshing, you know? I mean, once your eyelashes thaw when you get back inside, it's just so refreshing and bracing, you know? You just feel like you scrubbed out the inside of your lungs because you froze off that top gunky layer, you know? You're all fresh again.
Well, I love your optimism, Flavia. I always say there's about 2 weeks out of the year everyone wishes they lived here. And then the rest of the year, we're all wanting to get out of here. So I appreciate that. Thank you.
Yeah. Well, you know, bring your wife, come out to California, visit this way. And then you get best of all worlds. You know,
there you go.
Because Chicago does have a culture and a hustle and bustle that is just amazing. So you do get a lot there. Quick question for you. How do folks get in touch with you if they want more of your expertise and want to learn more about either your services or just some of your viewpoints? I know you've written books. You know, you've put a lot out there that folks can learn about, and a lot of it just has really good guidance.
Yeah, thank you. We are pleased to connect with anyone who'd be interested in chatting further. I don't charge a fee just to have a quick conversation and to answer some of your initial questions. We have a podcast that we've been putting out weekly for the last year or two, and you can go to notyouraveragefinancialpodcast.com or just go to your podcast app. We're all over the place, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, everywhere, Google. And if you go to our website, notyouraveragefinancialpodcast.com, there's a little button that says Meet with Mark, and you can certainly click that and find a time right there on my calendar to schedule a quick 15-minute, 20-minute meeting to just get to know each other and see if we're a good fit. If you mention that you met me through Flavia's wonderful podcast, do mention that, and I'll be happy to send you a copy of my book, Compliments of Flavia.
That would be awesome. So everyone, notyouraveragefinancialpodcast.com, and then be sure to click to set up a meeting with Mark, because Mark, you are a pleasure to talk to. You are so knowledgeable, and you just give real inspiration for next steps. You know, even me, I feel I do a pretty good job of this sort of planning. And, you know, I have great advisors. And whenever I talk to a great advisor like you, it just makes me realize there's more that can be done. And just like what we talked about with being on a bicycle or, you know, a high wire, financial planning is not set it and forget it. You definitely don't just do it once then just kind of like hope it's still working 10 years later. It takes constant adjustment and attention and focus. You know, it's like growing a garden. You can't just plant the seeds and walk away. You have to constantly tend it, move things around, pull the weeds, you know, replant and water the thing. So yeah, no, thank you so much for all that you do for folks to keep them not just financially healthy in their current life, but you know, that future person that shouldn't be a stranger, that should be a friend and some should be family, should be, it's you, it's yourself many years in the future, for keeping that person in good shape as well.
That's right. If you remember, there's a Simpsons episode where I think Homer is drinking some sort of weird cocktail of, I don't know, some household items. And Marge says something like, you know, isn't that harmful to you? And, you know, what would future Homer say to you? And he says, wow, future Homer, I don't envy that guy. And then he takes another drink. Right. So don't be Homer.
Don't be Homer. And, you know, along those lines, I guess, you know, everyone, come on, quit smoking, quit drinking.
Yeah, all that.
Be nice to future Homer, future you. So thanks, Mark. It's been a pleasure to have you on. Can't wait till next time when we chat again.
Likewise. Thanks. Have a great day.
You too. Hey everyone, thank you so much for joining us, and I hope you enjoyed the show. Don't forget to subscribe to this podcast, and if you leave a review on iTunes, I promise I will read every single review. If you know someone who makes a full-time living from part-time work, and maybe this is you, please visit lifestylesolopreneur.com to nominate a guest or to nominate yourself. Because remember this, money doesn't buy happiness. But money in the hands of a happy person, there is no greater tool.
Today's episode was brought to you by the Get Shift Done program. It's a lifestyle-changing online class to help you define your business and lifestyle ambitions and to set goals in a way you've never experienced before. This class will 10x your daily productivity with methods that will blow your mind. And if you use the coupon code PODCAST, the class tuition is 99% off. Visit getshiftdone.com to enroll today.